Alrighty. Hello, everybody. Yes, it is 9:30 p.m. on a Sunday, and I should be getting ready to go to bed so I can get ready for work tomorrow. But I just finished 5 hours today alone of working on a final project for an online class that I'm taking. And final projects are always stressful, so I am just gonna spend a little bit of time playing Stormworks to kind of unwind before I go to bed. Just let all that go. So something I had in mind for a few days now was to do a tutorial of how to make a simple car, which is why I'm letting you see this not-so-simple car ahead of you right now. And I know I've missed the boat on Stormworks. Like, I haven't been around during all of its alpha development and early access and all that jazz. But I am obsessively playing this game now. It is my new Kerbal Space Program. I absolutely love this game. It has its faults, just like Kerbal Space Program has its faults, but I just can't get enough of this game right now. It is so amazing. It gives me all the same thrills that KSP gave me, like making me feel like I'm playing some kind of a digital Legos for adults kind of game. That's exactly the feeling that KSP gave me, and Stormworks has given me that same exact feeling, and I'm just loving it. So the point of me making a tutorial is kind of out of date. I imagine people who are into this game have already been playing this game, and me making a tutorial is kind of redundant. But let's just do it for the sake of an exercise, just in case somebody new happens to come along and stumbles upon my channel. I pity the people. I pity you terribly. This is just a little habit of mine. I've gotten to the habit of like painting my original block just so I have an idea of where my center point is, and then I do everything else in the default white. But just something I've been doing. Don't worry about it. That black block will probably be deleted at some point, but it's just to help me get a sense of where I am, what my dimensions are. Let's say you're in a new career in this game and you want to make a land vehicle, or you're just starting out in creative mode and you have no idea what to do and you feel like a land vehicle would be a good place to start. How would you go about that? Well, that's kind of what this is going to be about today, or tonight, or whatever time zone we're in. And I would very much like to use the wheels with suspension. These things seem to be quite fun. I've only played with them a couple of times. But, I mean, suspension is cool. Makes the car look bouncy. Cars going over bumps at high speed, like dune racers or something like that. It's good stuff. So I'll be using the 3x3. And 3x3 literally just means the size of the wheel. It's measured in 3x3 blocks. So that's the size of the wheel. And we could also do, like, you know, 5x5, 7x7. You get the idea. But we'll be sticking with 3x3 for now. And I could also go with the non-suspension 3x3 wheel, but there's a reason I'm using the suspension version, and we'll get to that in a few minutes. Okay. So let's try to get a general sense of how big this car should be just by sort of placing some wheels down onto it, looking at it from various angles. Does that seem about car-ish? Maybe a little bit on the wide side, but consider the alternative. If I were to drop a wheel in like that, that would look, I think, a little bit too narrow in my opinion. And that'll become more obvious once I start adding things like seats. So I can throw in a driver seat. And passenger, nope, sorry, passenger seat. See, there you go. Everything, all the vehicles in this game have an annoying tendency to be measured in odd numbered blocks. You can't, I mean, you could, but it feels weird to shift a vehicle onto the line between blocks as being the center point, because then, you know, if you had a propeller at the back or the front or something, you know, where would you stick that propeller? That's kind of a large propeller, sorry. It's a very large propeller. Where would you stick the propeller? You could only place blocks onto other blocks. You can't place them onto the lines between the blocks. So if you made the lines between blocks be your center point, then any sort of centralized propulsion that you attach would be off-center. So inevitably, we sort of fall into a habit of using or building vehicles that are odd numbers of blocks across. So that's why I have my seats arranged like this. And because I have my seats arranged like that, we end up seeing that a vehicle that's only this wide at front looks a little bit on the narrow side, maybe? I mean, it'd be okay for a road car, but I want something that's sort of a little bit beefier than that. Actually, you know what? Let me challenge myself. Let me try to make a decent looking 3-wide car. Let's just do it anyway. Okay, so we'll get rid of those. Put these wheels back on. That's too close to the driver's seat, obviously. Or too close to the passenger seats. I guess I can move the driver's seat forward, but then we have a problem of where are you going to put the engine? Because the engine takes up a fair bit of space, even though it is the smallest of the three. So you have medium, large, but you start out with small in career mode. And, oops. There you go. So that's your engine. And that's just not enough space. The vehicle really needs to be a little bit longer than that if you're going to have a 4-seater space to work with. So let me put something up here as kind of like a firewall. We'll reattach it to the engine, have it facing this way at least temporarily, just so we can get a sense of scale. And then we'll need to have something coming out the front. So at the minimum, the vehicle's going to be that long in front, at a minimum. And then that's probably an okay place for the front wheel. Rear wheel really should probably be back a bit farther. Whoops. I don't know why I tried to spell there. And then, yeah, that's looking like an awfully long vehicle and kind of narrow, which is sort of why I was going for 5x5 or 5-wide in the first place, but we'll digress, or we'll not digress, we'll continue on. Okay, so let's go 2 past the mounting point as our rear. And there we go. That's as long as the vehicle's going to be when all is said and done. Oof. Possibly, maybe. Maybe, possibly. I might shift the wheels back. Shift the seats back. Yeah, let's do that. Let's move things back if we can, just a smidge. And the turning wheels are going to need to turn, so let's drop in a space so they're not too crowded. Like that. Okay. Yeah, let's move all the seats back one. Okay. We'll go with that. Okay. This isn't going to be a fancy vehicle. I'm not going to decorate it with doors and roof and windows and all that jazz. This is just going to be something that's kind of functional, has places for all the stuff it needs. That's pretty much it. We'll probably end up putting a fuel tank at the back, but we'll worry about the exact placement for that later on. And which seats are heavier? Passenger seat weighs 6 units of mass. Driver's seat weighs 7. Okay, yeah, so 7. Driver's seat is slightly heavier. If I needed to mount the tank that way, I could offset the mass by having it hang over to the right a little bit. Just trying to keep that purple center of mass highlight in the middle, which you can change with this right here. I think it's actually off by default, which seems weird to me, so if you need to enable it, there's the button to do so. Yeah, so let's look at the engine. How do we want to mount this? Well, there are actually a bunch of different options for that. I am using my keys to rotate this, and right now I'm pressing L to rotate it around the blue axis. I could also press K to rotate around the green axis, or J to rotate around the red axis, like that. And all the letters next to those, like O, I, and U, would flip the engine back and forth across that axis. So for example, pressing U, that was actually a bad example. Sorry, flip it back and forth along that axis is what I should have said. So pressing I should flip it. That's also not a good example. Well, just press your flip buttons. You'll see what I mean. You can, like right now I'm pressing O actually to flip it upside down. I can press I to flip it back to front, and I can press U to flip it side to side. Doesn't look like there's much of a change happening there, but actually there is a difference in... There is actually a difference in these middle ports up on top. You see the back up here is symmetrical, and the lone centralized port is obviously symmetrical because it's in the center. But in between, we have a slight offset in the grayness. So you see on this side, the gray kind of goes into the middle of the blue pipe area. And on this side, the gray falls a little bit short of the center of the blue circle area. Well, the difference between those is that the one that goes to the center is your fuel, and the one where the gray stops a little bit short of center is the exhaust. Doesn't sound like a big difference, but if you're absolutely desperate to have your exhaust be on, say, the right side of the vehicle, reorient the camera like this so it makes a little more sense. If you really want the exhaust to be on the right side of the vehicle, then you would probably want to flip the engine so the exhaust port ends up on that side. So let's see here. So we want short of center to be on the right side of the vehicle, and now exhaust is coming out over there. Okay, good. So one thing you can do to make it a little bit easier on yourself to remember which ports are which is to color code the pipes that you have coming out of them. So for example, we can say like this one is, sorry, no, that's that was exhaust, right? Say exhaust is smoky. All right, and then this one is your fuel to be combustible. And then we can say that the pipe up front is your air intake, and we'll give that some sort of an airy color. And then we have our coolant coming in, so we can make that be blue if we want to. And obviously the hot coolant coming out would be red. There you go. So that's sort of your or my little color coding, if you'd like. And then finally we have power. And actually, since power is orange, I should probably give that the orange color. And like turn combustible fuel into something else. Maybe possibly. Actually, it is the light color, isn't it? You know what? Let me recode that as being... I'm sorry, I can leave it there. Grab my paintbrush tool, make sure it's on brush mode, and I can just like recolor that yellow. So there we go. Yellow is combustible. That's what we'll do. We'll say yellow is combustible. And we'll give this pipe up front be our power. That works. Okay, so there you go. We have a color-coded engine port system now. Now the question comes, is do we want to have all these pipes arranged in this order? Well, coolant usually comes from a radiator, and in most vehicles the radiator sits at the front of the vehicle, so you know, that's where cool air is impacting it as it's driving along. And I sort of tend to conform to that fashion, so what I'm going to do is actually flip this thing around. There is a selection grid tool here in the game where you can drag the grid to encompass things like your entire engine, if you like. But once you have selected the engine and then you want to do something with it, unfortunately all you can do is move it and then repaste it somewhere else in the editor. We don't have any tools yet to like rotate the thing, so unfortunately if I want to rotate the engine I have to completely reapply it. So that's what I'll do, because that's what my plan was all along. Oh, I'm so helpful. Okay, so sorry about that. Let's wipe all these out. This is not a good tutorial. This is a good thing I'm streaming right now and not like recording for an official tutorial, because this is just terrible. Okay, let's see, which side is the exhaust on? Exhaust is on that side. Okay, that's fine. And let's recode everything. Put all our pipes back in. Let's see here. And actually, you'll have Google going out that way. There we go. Have these go that way. This go that way. And that go that way. And then paint them all. So, exhaust was on that side. Whoops. There we go. And then combustible fuel. There we go. And I forgot which coolant this is. This is in coolant. Okay. So in coolant would be... Whoops. In coolant would be cold, out hot. This is air. I guess we could just whatever. And then power. Okay, good stuff. All right, now let's add in a radiator. And we'll go back to white, so it's a little bit easier to see. You have a bunch of options about how to arrange this radiator. How you get those pipes to connect up to it are up to you. I like to have the pipes facing forward just because I think it's a little bit easier to reach, and I like to have the radiator directly in front of the engine. So I can either do this, or to make the pipe reach a little bit shorter I can rotate them up like that, and then all we have to do is just circle the pipes around. There we go. Okay. Looks a little bit goofy, but we can fill up that space with something else if we need to later on. Okay, let's see, exhaust. I was talking about that. How am I going to get my exhaust back to there is a good question, because we really don't have any good routes back from there. And I would like to make this vehicle be four-wheel drive at some point, although given that it's only five blocks across as a base, there really aren't any great places for me to send an exhaust pipe through, especially because the suspension things are so much in the way. I guess what we could do if we needed to is stick the wheels a little bit lower, but then does that look natural for that car? That's a pretty high seating position, I think. That's seeming much more like a specialized off-road vehicle than some sort of an ordinary car. I think I'll leave them where they are. Just deal with it. So, how to get the exhaust back there? That is a question we have to answer. And I'm not sure I have a good answer for that. Let's see, I might actually send you back... Whoops. Send you backwards. And then come down like this. That's not what I pressed. It is what I pressed, but ignore that fact. Wow, my mouse is just not acting right now. Alright. Okay, so yeah, we'll have the exhaust go down through there. And then once it's down to that point, I can have it come out and go around if I need to. But yeah, I think I'm going to have to at some point. Unless I have the exhaust mounted up high. Oh, I could have a side-mounted exhaust. That would be kind of fun. Never done that before. Sure, let's do a side-mounted exhaust just for the lulz. Okay. There we go. So we'll do that. And we'll connect right there. Yeah. Okay, and let's start putting in our floor pipes, our enclosed pipes. There we go. So that's connected top and bottom. See? Top and bottom. Okay, and then we just need a straight back from there. Hiya. And then another angle. And then a side-mounted exhaust. They do give you an exhaust port that actually looks like an exhaust, but if you don't like that, you can pretty much use just about anything that they have. So, in addition to the exhaust I just showed you, we also have fluid ports like that, fluid intakes like that, and big round or big rectangular fluid intakes like that. And all of these do the same job. I have yet to observe any throughput capacity limitations on any of these things. They all do the same job, all four of these things. So you can both intake with them and I think output with this as well. Is that only an intake? In and out, yeah. Port used to allow fluid in and out of a system. And in this case, the gas, such as exhaust, counts as fluid. So yeah, all four of these do the same thing. So it's just a, you know, style preference. But we are making a car, so this kind of looks like what we would want. And my only complaint right now is that it's not quite out far enough. Oh, actually, you know what? We might as well put a catalytic converter on there, just so the car is a little bit less smoky. And that is the exhaust out port, so that's the correct orientation for the catalytic converter. And there we go. Okay, and let's add in a few more blocks so that wheel doesn't look orphaned sitting out there. Or is that going to be too close? That looks a little bit on the snug side. But we have to support the seat somehow. You know what? I'll do this, and then we'll squeeze in a little rectangular block. Let's see here. There we go. Sure. Do the same thing back here, I guess. Okay. And then we'll try to fill in the space. Yeah. Yeah, we'll flip that around. It's gonna look a little bit goofy. It's okay. It's okay. Alright. Next, let's try to get... What is this, the air intake? Actually, I was just pointing out air intake ports. We can... how do I want to do this? Let's actually go... actually... how do I want to do this? I might... have that go out to the side, go around... I really would like it to be four-wheel drive at some point, but I might have to give that up. I don't know. Yeah, I probably have to give that up at some point. Nah, we'll stick with it. I'm going to make it four-wheel drive. I am going to do that. But what I'm trying to do, what's the thought that's going on in my head right now, is I'm trying to do this little number where I have something that looks kind of cool, like this angled piece be up here. And flip it one way or the other, doesn't really matter. And then the air intake would snake around to the front and connect to its underside somehow, with, you know, a pipe going in, and, you know, we'd get our magic airflow. But not seeing any good egress routes out of here, because I need to have the power coming back up along this column of the car, which means the fuel has to go back through this column of the car right underneath the middle of the driver's seat, and that doesn't leave any good place to put the air, because then it would connect out there, it'd be too blocky. And yeah, so I think instead of doing what I wanted to do, I'm just going to have to do something slightly less cool, which is to go back to this little angle bracket and just put a basic fluid port right here, facing forward. That's gonna have to be what I settle with for now. Yeah, I think so. Which makes the fact that this radiator doesn't have a top-mounted in and out port all the more annoying, because I would love to just have it be, you know, something that looks like this. Wrong buttons. There we go. I'd love to have the pipes just going in like that, right? And then just get rid of this stuff right here. But unfortunately, it's not going to let us do that. Yeah. All right. So we'll let that go. There's our air intake. Okay. And finally, the fuel. How do I want to do this? I need to go out and around. Yeah, I think I might just go... For the sake of pipe cleanliness, I think I'm going to have it go... Oh, sorry, I deleted two things. I only meant to delete the one. I think I'm going to have it go like that. My mouse is not working tonight. There we go. And then instead of actually going into that spot, what I will do is have it do a little scoot over to the side. There we go. Okay, there we go. And now the fuel will go back through there to somewhere, wherever we end up having the fuel. Somewhere. It'll be in there somewhere. Yeah, we'll figure that out later. Okay, which means that eventually I need to have power going back that way. And somewhere along the way it has to be branched out and sent back. I guess I could do that as soon as I have all of my other components in. So, what do we need to connect all the power? Well, let's first put in our little floor piece right here. And the next thing I like to have is a gearbox in case I need to go in reverse. And it doesn't matter what order you attach these things in either. And because it's going to be a reverse gearbox, it doesn't matter which way it's facing. More about that in another video, I'm sure. Then I need a clutch. Don't need a clutch, but it helps to have a clutch, I think. Okay. And fortunately, it doesn't matter which way the clutch is facing. Alright, and then that is pretty much all we need. So we got a reverse gear and a clutch, and I'll set these things up later, but I'm just placing them for now. Yeah, so I guess if that's all I need, then I can actually make the four-wheel drive branch out right here and go back to the front wheels. So that's what I'll do right now. I want it to be a T branch because part of it's going to continue on. Well, the other part goes to the front from here. Oh, nice, attached just the way I wanted it to. Okay, there we go. And we'll put another T back here. Come on, there we go. Okay, and then right to there. That's good, okay. So now, this allows me to get to the fuel port, kind of, sort of, I guess, maybe, possibly. I'll have to move the tank at some point. Let's see, how do I want this to be positioned? Let's try that right there. Yeah, we'll live with that. Okay, so more piping. There's a lot of piping in this game, especially when it comes to the combustible engines like these. Got to set up all their necessary components. There we go. So there's an angle coming up, and then a straight back from... Oh, I still need an angle going that way. And then a straight all the way from one end to the other for the fuel. Fill in a little gap right there. And straight to the front of the vehicle. Put another T. And across. There we go. So now it's going to be four-wheel drive. We have the drivetrain going backwards to the rear axles and bending back forward to the front axle. The fuel line's going backwards. The exhaust line's going backwards. We got everything we need for piping taken care of, just about. A few finishing touches here. Okay, and that'll do it for that. There are other things that we need, but I'll get to them. I'll add them in as they become relevant. For the engine, in order to start it, we have taken care of all of its pipe inputs and outputs, but it also has an electrical input in order to enable it to start. It needs to fire its spark plugs. So what I've done is I've gone from the building screen, which I guess is when you have none of these selected, you're in the building screen. So I've gone from the building screen to the logic screen. And once in the logic screen, I've clicked on electric, and now you can see there's a yellow circle inside the engine. So we also need to supply the engine with electricity. To do that, we need to give it a battery of some kind, and in a new career mode, you would start with a small electric battery. So we'll just throw this anywhere old place for now. Actually, no, I gotta be thinking ahead a little bit. Let's not throw this any old place for now. Let's put this somewhere. You know, batteries usually go by the engine, so we'll put this up by the engine as well. Guess it doesn't really matter super much where I put it. Does it? It doesn't really matter. I need something to stand on, though. I don't like it being there. Sorry, I'm being a little bit petty right now. I don't like it being there. Here, we'll do that. That's fine. How much does that weigh? Ooh, that's 10 pounds. Ooh, that's going to offset our center. Yeah, that offset our center quite a bit. You know what? I'm going to change my mind. I don't want the battery to be there. It's heavy. I guess I could put another one on the other side to balance it out. Actually, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put it on this side to begin with. There we go. Yeah. Sort of balances out the driver's seat a little bit now. Yeah, that's what we'll do. So battery's on the right side now. Anyway, so the battery will provide juice to start the engine, but that depletes the battery as we, you know, continuously do restarts along our journey. So the battery has to be replenished at some point, and the way we do that is by siphoning power off of the engine. In order to siphon off power, we need a generator. So what I'm going to do is replace this angled piece with a T-junction. And just recolor that. And I'm going to attach the small generator. You can basically think of this as the engine's alternator. So now, this generator will pull power off of the engine, and we can have it hooked up to recharge the battery, and then the battery can ignite the engine. But I'm going to add in something called a breaker to control all the circuitry in the vehicle. And for now, I think I'll just put this like right... It's really no good place for it, to be honest. Let's build a little block bridge so we have something to work off of. Let's put that right in the middle. Right in the middle bottom of the floor. That kind of works, I guess, a little bit. We'll make it work. Alright, so we got our breaker. And now, apart from the generator and battery, we now have all the other systems that will be routed through the breaker just to control all the electricals at once. So I'm going to go from generator to battery, then from battery to breaker, and then from breaker out to everything else. So now I'm going to hold down control so I can make multiple attachments simultaneously. There we go, I've just attached all three of those other things to the flip switch side of the breaker. So here's the breakers in, here's the breakers out to distribute the power. All right. So now we have power to the engine, to the reverse gearbox, and to the clutch. So that should enable everything to work, at least as far as electricity goes. We'll come back to that. Okay, let's see. What else do we need? Well, I don't want to jump into controls just yet, but I think I might have to anyway. You know what? Let me make a quick digression here. While we're still sort of... Well, we have fluids and piping and all that stuff fresh in our minds. Let me add in a fuel filler cap thing. So let's change this from angle to a T. And I'm going to make a spot where we can refill the vehicle when we arrive at a petrol station. Okay, so let's swivel this around, and we have just enough space to put in a fluid hose anchor. And there we go. And then, of course, we can look for a hose, and we'll have a hose somewhere on the vehicle. Probably not there, but, I mean, somewhere nearby we'll have a hose. Even though every gas refueling station you would go to in the game has its own hose nearby, I think it helps to have a hose with you in the field just in case you need to transfer fuel from one vehicle to another. So I usually include a hose somewhere on the vehicle. Not strictly speaking necessary, but it's what I like to do. And since we're talking about hoses and inventory stuff and all that, I will pull up our massive list of inventory parts, otherwise known as specialist equipment. And all these things are inventory parts. And the one biggie that I really want, that I think everybody or every vehicle should have, where is it? I'm looking for R. There it is, R, rope. Is a rope. And in addition to having a rope, you also need some place to attach the rope. Actually, let me turn these things so they're facing the rear of the car. Oops, that's not what I meant to do. There we go. In addition to having a rope, it's also a good idea to have a place to attach the rope. So, let's see. Rope anchor. That is a good thing to have on any vehicle. I highly recommend it. And let's put one at the front, too. There we go. Okay, so a rope anchor front and back. Good thing to have. Very valuable. Don't want to leave home without it. Okay, so there. We have all of our piping done. We have hoses, we have ropes, we have connections, we have electricity. The next thing we need to think about is how to make all the systems interact with each other so that the vehicle can start to move. I'm going to take a quick break, just check on chat here. Coffee AK, Veos, hello! Feels like work. Make it pink. Okay, yeah, we can color the car pink. Oh my god, 38 minutes. This is supposed to be a 10-minute tutorial. Man, I'm going to have to cut down my stuff quite a bit. Okay. Oh, good grief. All right, let's keep this as basic as possible. What we need to do now to make all the systems interact with each other is start going into our logic. Logic has all kinds of fun stuff, like data, which controls our red and green inputs and outputs. Red inputs outputs are binary systems, either yes, no, on, off, that kind of stuff. And green inputs outputs are numerics. They are sort of analog. They have a variable range of values that you can apply to them or derive from them. So the engine has a red input. Inputs are the hollow circles, outputs are the solid circles. So here's an input, output, input, etc. You get the idea. So the engine has a red input, and this is for its starter. Basically, it just needs to receive a solid continuous signal saying, hey, it's time to start the engine. Now, we don't want to continuously try to start the engine because that would rapidly deplete our battery. We just want to give the engine a quick jolt to start its invisible spark plugs. And once the engine is running, then we can disengage the starter. But to begin with, we just need one continuous take that starter. So what we're going to do is give it a key, because a key is how most vehicles like to start, or how most automobiles have their ignitions looking like, is a basic turnkey. You know, stick a piece of metal in, give it a twist. All right. Now, unfortunately, when you're starting a new career, you won't have the key piece as your initial start. It's not one of the blocks that you start with. One of the blocks you do start with is the toggle switch. Now, fortunately, both the key and the toggle switch output a red signal, or you can have them output a red signal. So they both serve exactly the same purpose. It's just that, in my opinion, you know, the key looks cooler. but they can both work exactly the same way. So because I want this to look a little bit neat, let's stick with the key. And we're going to have the key connect up to the engine. There we go. So output from the key goes to the input of the engine starter, and this will enable us to start the engine. I don't like to spend an entire second turning the key, so I'm going to turn or reduce its hold duration from 1 second down to like 0.3 seconds is what I like to go with. I'll just call this ignition if we want to. There we go. Okay. And then I might want to move that a little bit closer later on. We'll get to that later. Let's see. And basic stuff we want to know. We want to know how fast we're going to be going. We want to know how hot the engine is getting, because we don't want to, you know, overrun it or you know, overheat it and have it go kablooey. Actually, that dial might be a little bit close. I might have to back that up a little bit. See if we can get dials going along that row. Yeah, that might be a little bit better. Okay. So yeah, we want to know how fast we're going, how hot the engine's getting, possibly how much fuel we have so we don't overextend ourselves. Those are probably the basics that you want to know, but when you actually start playing this game, you'll find that not knowing exactly what your settings are for certain inputs can be a little bit distracting or confusing. So I think it also helps to have things like throttles in here, so you can actually see what your settings are. And for that, there's actually a throttle part that looks like a lever, and let me just get it someplace where you can see it. So that's what a throttle looks like. The positive, or the solid arrow, indicates the direction in the positive, or the indicates the positive direction. And when I'm talking about positive, I mean like positive numbers, because the output from the throttle is a green numeric. So by moving the lever in the positive direction, we give increasingly positive numbers. And by moving it in the negative direction toward the hollow arrow at the back, we give it increasingly negative number outputs. All right, so positive outputs, negative outputs, right? Solid arrow, hollow arrow, positive, negative. All right, now, to enable us to see that, I'm going to drop these blocks right here and probably put a throttle down in the footwell, like so, and another one over here for the clutch. There you go. So we'll have throttle be by the right foot, because I think that's where most cars have it. And then clutch will be by the clutch pedal, because that totally makes sense. Okay. All right, so starting to get a little bit dense with circles, but don't worry about it. We're just focused on the green ones right now. So green output from the right foot throttle is going to go to the engine's green input for the amount of throttle it takes. And the green output from the left foot pedal is going to go to the clutch, because that'll tell the clutch how much to be engaged. And since the clutch goes from a range from 0 to 1, we can... Actually, let me... Hang on. Hold that thought. Still connecting things. So, we got our throttle hooked up. We have our clutch hooked up. I said I want to know how hot the engine is going to be. how much fuel we have, how fast we're going. I guess it doesn't really, we don't need to know how fast we're going, but it's a nice, it's sort of a nice reward. Like, yay, I'm doing 50 or something like that. So let's say engine heat. Engine heat or temperature or something like that. Now I happen to know from experience that heat ranges from 0 to a danger zone of over 100. So we'll have that set up. Let's have the middle one be the speedometer. Speed! And let's be a little bit realistic. We'll be lucky if we hit 30. This is in meters per second, by the way. So like a good rover and KSP using basic technology, no exploits or anything, would probably be lucky to hit about 40 on Kerbin. So here in the game, 30 meters per second seems a little bit slow, but vehicles can be pushed up to much higher speeds if you start messing with things like how high the engine is allowed to rev and stuff like that. So we'll stick with 30 on our speedometer. And then, let's see, fuel, I guess, would be nice. We put fuel in there. And I don't know how much fuel we actually have in here, so let me do a quick test to see how much fuel is in here. I think these things hold 180, but let me just quickly spawn it and go look at it. 178 in the tank and probably a little bit more out in the pipes. So yeah, we'll take that back and we'll say the fuel meter's maximum limit should be 180. And then if I happen to forget that the max is 180, I can give myself a little reminder, say like max 180, something like that. Max. There we go. Okay, so we have our three basic meters. You can obviously give yourself a lot more dials and a lot more information, but I think that's probably a good starting place for now. And the last thing I want to do is have a toggle switch for lights, just because that's how I like to do. So toggle switch for the lights, because eventually we might want to add lights to this. Okay. Actually, let's add the lights right now since we're talking about it. Let's add some lights. We'll put in some spotlights up front so we can actually cast some beams a good distance ahead, see where we're going. And I want two of those. That looks okay. Maybe a little bit wider. A little bit higher? Hang on, what am I trying to do? I'm trying to do this and then grab that. I just held down control while I was doing that. Very similar to holding left alt when you're in KSP. There we go. About like that. Yeah. And then we'll do a similar arrangement out here at the back. But instead of having casting beams, we'll just have local generic omni illuminators. Like that. And then we can color them. We can say, let's have some bright shiny xenons at the front and some red brake lights at the back. Now, instead of going with the brush mode of the paintbrush, I'm going to go to additive, and that allows me to color just the lights instead of coloring the entire block like that. So brush mode allows me to color the surface, additive allows me to color the light bulb. Okay. So additive mode, let's make the front lights be like a bright blue. There we go. Get our xenons in there. Okay. There we go. And is that about it? Oh, we're going to hook up the lights, that's right. So now we want to have the toggle switch activate all the lights. So again, I'm holding down control and clicking each of the circles as I go. There we go. We have lights now. And let's get information for the dials that we just installed. So, engine heat. The engine outputs two values. It outputs temperature and RPS. RPS is a good thing to know, but we're trying to keep this a little bit simple, so we're omitting the tachometer right now. Although I guess speed is probably less important than engine RPS, but you know, speedometer, tachometer, do you really need both? fuel, we'll take the green output from the fuel tank, put that into the fuel, and speed, we actually need something to measure our speed. So, we have angular speed sensor and linear speed sensor. We want the linear one because we're going to be going mostly forward in a straight line. And I can put this pretty much wherever I want to, actually. Well, Maybe we'll have it somewhere on the inside. Doesn't really matter, just as long as it's facing forward. There we go. That's good. Okay. And out back, I might actually put like a handle so somebody can grab onto the vehicle and pull it if they need to. Just in case. Okay. I think it's looking pretty good right now. Yeah, so we got a linear speed sensor. Let's hook up that thing's data value to our final dial. There we go. Dials now have their inputs. Now the last thing I want for the dials is to illuminate them, because while they seem bright and shiny here in the building editor, when you actually get out onto the road, they can be completely obscured by darkness if you're driving around at night. So one thing that these dials have is a backlight illuminator option, and that is activated with the red logic. And since we already have a toggle switch activating the vehicle's outer lights, we might as well use that same toggle switch to activate the inner lights, in this case the backlights, for each of the dials. There we go. So now we can make our dials shinier and easier to see. Okay. And I think we're almost done. The last big thing I want to take care of is the wheels. We put on the wheels right at the start of this construction process, but now it would be nice to make sure that they're actually going to spin and turn in the correct directions. If we look back here, you can see, actually let's start with the front right one. If we look at the front right wheel, we see that the, I wish there was a better way to grab that. Anyway, forgive the block being in the way. We can't get rid of the construction block when we're in this particular view. But if you look at the solid arrow that's going clockwise around the wheel as we're looking at it right now, the solid positive arrow is the direction that the wheel will rotate when power is applied to it. And obviously, if we're looking at the right side of the vehicle, we want the tires to be spinning clockwise to make the vehicle go forward. Okay. And since we're looking at a turning wheel, because we're going to have the front wheels turn, we want to look at the arrows underneath the tire. And in this case, the positive arrow is going clockwise from this direction. So clockwise around, the positive arrow is going clockwise. And that means when I turn the steering wheel to the right, this wheel is going to go to the right. Now, there's a small hitch with this, in that the left side wheel is incorrect when it comes to the steering. It's going to roll in the right direction, but it's not going to turn in the right direction. You can see the arrow is going in the wrong direction. Now, if I get rid of this wheel and try to reapply it, I can flip the stuff around using our I, O, and U keys. So eventually I can flip it until the arrows are going in the right direction. Like so. So now we have the drive arrow still going in the clockwise direction. It just happens to be on the bottom of the wheel, but its direction of rotation is still in the correct forward direction of rolling. And if we look up, we can see that now the solid arrow is indeed turning to the right. So if I were to turn the steering wheel to the right, the left wheel will now turn to the right as directed. The only problem with this is we are using the wheels with suspension. And if I turn the camera so you can see that the suspension is underneath the wheel. And obviously that's not going to work. So, this is just a small fault of the fact that we only have one model for the wheels, or the wheels with suspension rather, and the wheels with suspension are only modeled for the right side of the vehicle. Sounds kind of strange. But there's a way we can get around that. Just reattach it in its original configuration like so. So you can see the steering arrow is going in the wrong direction. To make it go in the right direction, we can add something called a numeric inverter. And this will be only applied to the left front steering wheel. So we're going to add in a numeric inverter here. And what this is going to do is allow us... let me flip that the wrong way around. Or the right way around. What this is going to allow us to do is take our steering input to here, flip the number from positive to negative or from negative to positive, whichever way we happen to be turning the wheel at the time, turning the steering wheel at the time, and then the numeric inverter will output the value that the left steering wheel needs to receive in order to make the steering, the front wheel turn in the correct direction. Okay, so let's take our steering output and connect up the whole line. Normally this would be WASD, but I have my key binding set one to the right, so instead of WASD I use ESDF. So my turning keys are S and F. Let's look around, there's S and F. So we'll take steering to there. The numeric inverter will go down to the steering input for the left front wheel. Now, the right front wheel is correct as is because of how it's modeled in the game, so we can go directly from the driver's seat to the steering wheel input on the right side, and there will be no problem with the right side. The right side will work as intended. Okay, so there we go. There are our steering controls, and now they are compatible with the suspension that's been built into the left wheels. Okay, so that's what we do with that. Alrighty. Brakes. You know what? Let's dive off the deep end. Let's go crazy. What do I want here? I want all of the logic blocks to be visible to me. Brakes. What I'm going to do is use... actually, I should probably describe what I'm doing first. Let's look at the simpler alternative. I can use any of these red number outputs on the driver's seat, like hotkeys 1 through 6. I can use any of these red outputs to control the parking brake for any of the four wheels, but the parking brake locks up the entire wheel. It just completely seizes it and doesn't let go until you release your input. What I'd like to do is have a gentler braking system, and that would be the green inputs, where I can, instead of giving like a full logical one, you know, integer logical one, to say fully on, fully activate the brake, seize them up, stop the car immediately. Instead of doing that, I can apply a lesser number. Like, let's give it a 0.5 for a little bit of a softer touch. Okay, so that's what we're going to get to eventually. But the alternative is just to say, hey, let's just, you know, slam on space bar, you know, press our trigger key and just slam on space bar and completely lock up all four wheels. We can do that. That's fine. So we could use that as a parking brake if we want to. Like if we get to a location, we're parked on a hill and we need to get out of the vehicle and go do something like rescue some poor burning victims or something, you know, we can we can apply a parking brake, and that's fine. We'd probably want to do that. But if we're just driving along and we just want to slow down a little bit for a turn coming up, then I probably want to use the variable brake for a little bit of a smoother deceleration. So what I'm going to do is use two different logic blocks to connect my desire. Instead of giving a full logical one, I want to give like a logical, let's say 0.25, a quarter output. And for that, I'm going to use a constant number and put that somewhere in the vehicle. Let's just throw it down here for convenience sake. And I'm going to tell that constant number to be 0.25. Oops, let's call it 25. All right, now I need to do something to make that 0.25 connect up with my driver's seat inputs, or outputs rather, to go to the variable brakes on all of the wheels. And for that, I'm going to use a numeric junction. There it is. So the numerical junction waits for us to give a logic output from the driver's seat in some fashion. And then it's going to take the number that we've already assigned to our constant, what's it called? Our constant number block. And it's going to pass that number through when the numerical junction is active through the on path. And the on path will go out to all four of the wheels into their variable brake input. So let's draw it so you can see what I'm talking about. Actually, let's put this somewhere else so it's not like quite so conspicuous. All right. So we want constant number going in. Let's say we just use like the number one. Actually, in all honesty, I think it's probably easier to use spacebar because it's a little bit easier to keep track of. Let's use like parking brake. Let's use one for parking brake. I like that better. Let's use one for parking brake. There we go. And we'll use trigger for our signal to the junction. So the junction has our spacebar input, it has our numeric 0.25 input, and now we need to grab the on path. That's the off path, we want the on path. We take the on path output from the numeric junction, and we go to the variable brake input on all four wheels, and that will enable us to stop just a little bit more gently, or slow down a little bit more gently. There we go. And that is as complex as I'm going to get with logic blocks. We're done with logic blocks. We don't have to worry about that anymore. You can breathe once again. Okay. So that is pretty much it for the logic, with some small exceptions that I like to use hotkey shortcuts for the clutch and throttle. I might as well hook those hotkey shortcuts up right now since we're diving off the deep end. My personal preference, don't worry about this. You can use whatever numbers you want to. I'm just hooking up the numbers that I'm accustomed to for throttle and clutch. There we go. And those will allow me to use number hotkeys to control the throttle blocks, but I can also reach down and touch the throttle blocks with my mouse while we're driving around if I so desire. So mouse input and keyboard input will both work just fine. Okay. So, are we ready to drive? Well, I think we have all of our logic hooked up. We have steering, we have driving, we have brakes, the engine's all hooked up, it has all of its inputs and outputs. We have our logic blocks for steering in the correct direction, for doing gentle braking. The only thing that we haven't done is adjust the input types for the driver's seat and hook up the electricity. Oh yeah, we forgot all about electricity. So, S and F, those are my steering keys, left and right. Sensitivity by default is on 10, and their mode is reset as opposed to sticky. That's good. Same thing for all the other inputs. I like to use up and down as my clutch sometimes, but for now I'm using hotkeys 3 and 4 for clutch, so we won't worry about that. So, you know, if I were to be using up and down for clutch, I'd probably want it to be sticky because I want my clutch to stay at the level of friction that I applied it to. So that's what I do sometimes. Trigger is for our brakes. We do not want to toggle on brakes. We just want to be able to tap the brakes. So with it set to mode push, that means it will only output our red trigger signal to the brakes whenever, for only so long as I am pushing down on the space bar to activate the brake signal. If I were to put it on toggle, then all I would do is just tap the space bar and it would lock on my variable brakes and would continuously output that 0.25 until we came to a complete halt. And that's not what I want to do because that's what the parking brake does. So I'm going to leave this up, or I'm going to switch this over to push mode, and then I can just tap it and, you know, gingerly decelerate. And finally, my hotkeys. I'm using hotkeys 2 through 5 as my shortcuts for throttle and clutch. And I do want those to be push so that they go where I set them to go instead of running away without permission. Alright, and then the others are toggle, that's correct. So I think now, car stream 1. Let's hook up the electricity and we can go rolling. So we have a few more things in here since the last time we looked at this overlay. We have an ignition box, we have two throttle boxes, we have a few dials, a toggle switch, and I think that's all we have. Oh, and the lights. Yeah, the lights were new as well. Okay, so here we go. Ignition thing, throttle boxes, dials, toggle, and lights. You can also give power to the inventory boxes if you want to, but most inventory items do not require power for anything. Some of them do. For example, the defibrillator needs to be recharged when you're storing it, so that requires electricity to recharge. The oxygen mask somehow takes electricity and converts it into oxygen. I don't know, there must be some very tiny compressor in there somewhere. The handheld radio transponder locator thingy is battery powered, so that needs to be recharged. The night vision goggle, or the flashlight needs to be recharged. The night vision goggles, where are they? There we go, the night vision binoculars, rather. Those need to be recharged. So there are a few things that require electricity, and if you hook up electricity to the boxes that you're likely to store them in, and all these things could be interchanged. Like right now I have the red hose on the left and the black rope on the right. I could swap those around if I want to once I'm out driving the vehicle, it doesn't matter. So if I had like, you know, a defibrillator over here on the left and I was out in the field and I forgot which one I stored it in and I accidentally stored it back on the right, in that case I might want to apply power to both of them. But since all we're storing are hoses and ropes right now, we don't really need power to either of these. So I'm going to leave them unpowered. Okay. Let's go see if we can drive this now. And our final request, of course, was to make it pink. Fortunately, there's not a whole lot to make pink. Oops. Oh, I'm still in additive mode. Let's get a brush. There we go. There's not a whole lot in here that can be made pink, but we'll do our best. Let's make the exhaust pink, sure, why not? Let's make the seats pink too. Alrighty, go crazy with this. Lights all around, pink lights. It looks great. There we go. Okay. Oops. What did I do? It's pinkish. We got some pink going on here. All right, I think it's pretty good. Let's hit it. Pink. Okay, save. Launch. All right, check on chat here. Party Aurora, hello and hello, hello. Okay. So I'm going to, first of all, turn on power, so everything gets power. Then I'm going to press lights to make sure we have lights. And you can see when I do that, the dials light up. They become backlit, illuminated, so looks pretty nice. We have a soft red glow, or a soft pinkish glow on our dash, because the tail lights are actually shining through the seats. Something of an annoyance. I wish they didn't do that, but they do. They shine through the seats. So, I can turn throttle up a little bit by pressing that, or I can use my keyboard shortcuts that I assigned from the driver's seat. So throttle can go up and clutch can go up. And what we're going to do is turn the ignition and fire away. So we have fuel, speed, engine heat. Engine heat is already at 20 because this is in Celsius, so 20 is like room temperature. And actually, if we go to map view, the map view is quite large. I'm not going to spoil that for you if you haven't bought or played the game yet, but we go to a temperature overlay and we can see we're in like a dullish yellow green. That's because we're in a sort of subtropical area and everything north of here gets progressively more blue, like goes from sort of a yellowish green to a natural green, forest green, racing green, then transitions into teal and blue and everything else. So as you go north it gets colder, but right now we are in a subtropical area with pine trees for some reason, I don't know why, and the wind is really howling out there. Let's turn that down because we can, because we're in creative mode. Alright, so let's just do a steering check. Yep, the steering wheels move in the correct direction, that's what we want them to do, and let's fire it up. We are away. And we're going really fast. How fast are we going? Whoa, speed's up to 43. Oh god, we're going to hit something. Oh, whoa. Oh yeah. Oh man. I have a feeling the engine's about to catch fire if I keep going at this pace. In fact, let me turn down throttle a little bit. There we go. Let's just keep an eye on the engine. Yeah, there we go. Just turn that down a smidge. Okay. I think we're good. Yeah, we're good. Alright, so now we're cruising at a more manageable 14 meters per second in our pink car. Looking good, looking good. Obviously, it would take quite a bit of engineering finesse to style this thing to look like an actual automobile, but this is the basic shell. You got the basic chassis, four seats, lights, wheels, and a working engine, and transmission lines, fuel lines, all that stuff. So this could actually go places if we wanted to. Unfortunately, there's nothing really good around here to get a good workout with the suspension. So I think what I'm going to do is open up the map a little bit. I'll try not to reveal it for, Oh, there we go. Parking brake works. That was a test of the parking brake. Let's reset this back to the hangar. We're a little bit too far from the hangar for me to recover. Oh, I never put on the reverse gear. That's something I forgot about. I completely forgot about the reverse gear. Alright, well, good thing we're rolling backwards a little bit. Try to... That's not going to be enough room. Let me just reset. Load, autosave. The game automatically autosaves whenever you launch a vehicle, so that's fantastic. Because it's a little bit more complicated in multiplayer, of course, but, yeah. In single player, we don't have to worry about that. Okay, so we're back in the hangar where we started. Let me recover this and add in our reverse thing, because I completely forgot about reverse. My bad. Where can I put reverse? I don't have any good floor space for it. All my floor space is occupied. I can't quite put it there because, unfortunately, toggle buttons have a collision mesh for interaction, and you can see that by the red highlight. The red highlight that comes up when I rotate up or to the right, it's colliding with other things. And the throttle box above me has a similar collision mesh, so the two collision meshes are overlapping right there. So what I'm going to have to do instead is put it into this spot where there's no collision. That'll be where my reverse is. Unfortunately. Let's give this another color as well so I don't accidentally activate it. Actually, I think they're all red by default, aren't they? Make it pink. I don't know. Lights. Actually, let's make lights a bright blue. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so this will be our reverse gear. Just remind me what it is. It needs electricity so it can actually activate. And it needs to send its signal to our reverse gear, and then we need to tell the reverse gearbox to actually go in reverse. So when we turn it on with the toggle, it's going to go in reverse, so 1 to negative 1, that basically, you know, it reverses the gears, and that will allow us to go in reverse. Okay, and since we're back here in the editor, I feel like making my wheels just a little bit bigger. Let's make them 1.5 size. And let's give them a little bit stiffer suspension, because I plan on beating the heck out of these things. We'll go over some pretty hard bumps. I could also change their grip to be from all round to high speed. Oops, I'm still on the wrong wheel, my bad. From like high speed, high grip, or keep them all round. All round works pretty well. I'm not going to worry about it, but you do have the option. Tire radius, 1.5, and then tire radius, 1.5. Alright, there we go. Yeah. It's looking like a car. Sort of. Okay. We'll spawn this. Actually, no, I don't want to spawn it here, sorry. What I want to do is take it out to the map. So let's, what am I trying to get to? I'm trying to get to the custom menu, there we go. Let's reveal the map and unlock islands. And then I'm just gonna zoom out a little bit so I can find a place to teleport to that has land. Unfortunately that doesn't have a spawning spot there. Oh, this is a good spot. Let's go over here. Okay, so let me despawn this, bring it back to the editor, go out of the editor to despawn it, go to map, teleport over here, Go to. I need to open the doors, of course. Travel a little bit faster when you jump. No, not lights. Doors. There we go. Okay. And back to our workbench. Spawn the car here. There we go. And now we can drive it out onto land. There's actual land to drive to now. So let's go have some fun. So, power, lights, throttle and clutch. Maybe turn throttle down just a smidge. Don't need to go super fast. Power. And we are away. Oh yeah. Let's see what these wheels can do. Woohoo! Oh, they hit a little bit hard on that one. It's okay. Oh dear. I may have broken the right front bumper a little bit. It's alright. That's what repair torches are for, which I don't have on this vehicle, but that's okay. Whoa! Oh yeah. Nicely done. Oh, we got mountains off in the distance. Mountains and trees! Yeah, this thing's taking some abuse already. I can see some room for improvement in the design! Oh my gosh! Man, this thing is cruising. You know what? We are going a little bit fast. Let me just tap that brake a little bit. Okay, that works too. I was gonna say, I could just tap the brake to make sure that's working as intended. Yep, it works. Have I just stalled the vehicle? I think I might have just stalled it. Dear, I do not want to be driving through a forest. I don't have that kind of steering response. Let's yeah, we definitely startled it. Let's get throttle up to. Oh dear. Oh gosh, this is terrifying in first person. Oh, let's go back the way we came. Yeah. Let's go back the way we came. Obviously the engine sits a little bit high. So, like I said, some design finesse would be required to make this thing actually look like an automobile, but it works. It's a working chassis, and I realize you guys can't hear the game at all. You probably hear the wind, but not the vehicle. Actually, on that note, environment doesn't need to be that loud at all. Why is the vehicle so silent? Our engine is running silently. Strange. Let's see if we can turn that all the way up. There we go. Ooh. Tap the brakes. Yep, brakes work. Oh, we got a wind farm over there. Hello, wind farm. Let's go say hello. Full speed! Oh, there's the engine sound. Oh, yeah. Side-facing exhaust, spewing out smoke behind us. Oh god, whoa! Yeah. We're all good here. Everything's fine. How are you? Oh boy. There are actual roads in this game. There are not many, but they do exist. I wonder if I could go find one. I think there's one to our west somewhere. Which way is west, by the way? I have no idea. I think it's to my right. Oh, those are big windmills. Whoa, those are big windmills. Can we make it up this hill? We made it up the hill! Wow. Nice! Alright, what's parking brake? One? Yeah, let's get parking brake out of here. Put throttle down. There we go. Underneath a gigantic windmill. Let's go see if we can find a road. Where are we? Oh yeah, there's actually a road not too far. Or south, actually. South would be even better. Let's put a waypoint down near the bridge. Set a waypoint. Oh, there we go. I can see the bridge through my binoculars. Alright, cool. We'll see if we can make it over there without dying or destroying the car. So, let's see. Put those away. Parking brake off. Throttle up. Maybe not that much. Just a little bit to get out of here. And let's try to drive off the cliff. Oh, dear. We made it. Okay, we're good. Oh, hang on. I think I see a road right there. Oh, yep. Okay, not quite that fast. A little bit less thorough. I don't know if this road is going to take us to a connecting point, though. This might be just a loop through the windmill park. Yeah, I think it's just a loop through the windmill park. We got to get out of this forest somehow. Oh, that was a mistake. That was a mistake. That was a bad idea. I should never have done that. Mistakes were made. Okay. Yeah. Okay. No, we're not in a good spot right now. Oh, I think I'm gonna have to just bite the bullet and go through the trees. Oh, good opportunity to use our reverse gear. Reverse. Whoa. Okay. Out of reverse. A little bit less throttle. Oh, can we just coast through here? I'd love to just coast. I think I see a path. Yeah. Alright. Let's very carefully do this. Very carefully. That wasn't careful at all. We're fine. Road! I see a sweet, beautiful road! There's a road! Oh, we made it! We made it! We're at the intersection! Don't crash into the water! Crazy driver! Ah, there. We made it. To a bridge. Oh, there's a boat in the water. Hang on. There is a boat in the water. Alright, let's throttle down. And parking brake on. Oh, hello, little boat. That doesn't look like a very big boat, but let's just give it the courtesy of opening up the drawbridge, shall we? Let's see here. Yeah, he's coming along pretty fast. Alright, let's make sure we bring the drawbridge up. Uh-oh. I might have parked in a bad spot. Oh, dear. Oh! The fishy's eating the car! The headlights are illuminating the fishy! Whoops. Oh, hi there, Crow. Oh, man. Well, there you go, buddy. You're all set to pass through. I can't read the name on the side of your vessel, but Campbell or something, I think is what it says. Just, feel free to watch out for the flotsam underneath the... Hey, you ran into my bridge, man! Alright, that's it. I'm commandeering your vessel. If only we could. I wish we could commandeer the vessels. It is the Campbell. Okay. Wow, your engine's really loud with my volume turned up. Alright, step aside, Skipper. We gotta get over to my vessel. We have a nice living room in here. Oh, yeah. A little lunchbox and everything. That's cute. A little sleeping cabin. Very nice, very nice. Got a commode. As you do, yep, okay. And you're now trying to drive up the wall of the bridge. Okay, you're just a crazy driver. And you're sinking the vessel, okay. It's a sunken vehicle club that we're in, apparently. Good for you, man. And there lies our pink Jeep down at the bottom of the river. Alas, alas. Okay, well, there you go, guys. Hope you enjoyed that. That was a little look into Stormworks, and hope you learned something from that. Please, you know, give some feedback. I would like to do a tutorial on this at some point. I'm going to try to do a 10-minute tutorial. I'll have to be talking like a madman, take a lot of caffeine or something. I don't know. This is supposed to be a stream to wind down from doing an insane final school project for a class. And I don't know if I'm really wound down at all. I feel all hyped up. I want to drive somewhere now. But anyway, until next time, have a good night, guys. Have a good weekend. Or I guess the weekend's over, but you know what I mean. See you next time. Have a good one.